I'm Morgan Peckman, Editor-in-Chief of City and State, and this is Last Look. Today, our guest is election attorney Jerry Goldfeder with Strzok, & Levin. Jerry, thank you so much for joining us.
Sure, my pleasure.
Well, as it turns out, you and I have both written op-eds in the last couple days on the same subject, calling for the elimination of the runoff. What is your reasoning?
Well, there's a variety of reasons. We have approximately 10,000 elected officials in New York. We have 62 counties, we have 62 cities, we have over 900 towns, over 500 villages. There are only three offices, only three public offices where there is a runoff, obviously mayor and public advocate and the controller of the city of New York. On some level, it makes no sense whatsoever to just to pinpoint these particular offices and require a runoff. As you know, and some of your viewers will know, that this occurred in the early 1970s as a result of the fact that the Democratic leadership was not happy with the fact that Mario Procaccino won a primary with little over 32% of the vote. So Albany enacted a runoff, but just for these three offices. So it's not really rational. It's not a rational way of proceeding. If a runoff is such a good idea, why not have it for every office? I don't think that's going to happen. So I think actually the better way of going is to eliminate it.
Well, some people have called for instant runoff voting instead of just eliminating the runoff outright. Where do you side with that?
It's a good reform. If we're going to have a runoff, it seems to me that it would be better to have an instant runoff. We would save the city of New York, in this case, $13 million. You know, what's interesting is when the runoff was first proposed in the early 1970s, then Mayor Lindsay said, oh, this is going to cost a lot of money. At that time, he said $1.2 million. And he said it's an unfunded mandate, which it is. The state legislature passes the law, and the city of New York's Board of Elections, city of New York, has to pay for it. And it seems to me that we could save money by having an instant runoff. Plus, we have a hard time counting ballots here in New York City. It took this year 17 days to get the final results after the original primary. Again, in the early 1970s, one of the opposition cries was from the Board of Elections of the City of New York. They said, well, if there's going to be a runoff, it's going to be impossible to count the ballots. Sound familiar? We've heard this time and time again, and in fact, we've seen that. And that's even without squabbling lawyers. People like me who go in and challenge ballots on behalf of one candidate or another, we didn't have any of that this year, and it still took, with all the best intentions, a new executive director who's really put his shoulder to the wheel, it still took 17 days. And it seems to me that that's a long time to be able to count ballots. If we're going to have a runoff, it seems to me that an instant runoff would be a far better way of proceeding.
It seems like there's momentum growing for the idea of reforming the runoff, if for no other reason that the Public Advocate's Office only has a $2.3 million annual budget, and now we're going to spend $13 million deciding the contest. I read that Assemblyman Brian Kavanaugh intends to introduce legislation. Do you think that this is the justification, though, is just purely economic? I mean, if we were having Bill Thompson and Bill de Blasio right. running on Tuesday, would it still be a worthwhile argument to talk about reforming the runoff system?
It would be, but not for that reason. The fact that the Public Advocate's Office only has a small budget is really, in a way, beside the point. We've had runoffs for Public Advocate, we've had runoffs for Controller, we've had runoffs for Mayor. So it's the procedure that needs to either be reformed or eliminated, not because it's a runoff just for Public Advocate this time.
And what was the rationale initially for the introduction of the runoff? Was it so that a greater plurality or majority of voters would be represented ultimately in the nominee?
Well, the stated rationale was that we wouldn't have people nominated with a small portion of the vote. The unstated rationale by many observers back then was that it was a way of ensuring that Herman Badillo, who was a very popular Puerto Rican elected official and who had run for mayor and was going to run for mayor again, would not be elected, would not be nominated and elected. It was a little similar to the runoffs that were held in the South in order to prevent African Americans from being nominated. It may be easier for a Hispanic or a or an African American back then to get a greater share of the vote than any other candidate, but it would be more difficult to get a 40% or 50% of the vote. So some people felt that the original runoff, although it was stated that, well, we can't have somebody nominated with less than 40% of the vote because he or she wouldn't really represent the plural, a real solid plurality or a majority of the voters. An undercurrent was to prevent, in that case, a Puerto Rican from electing, being nominated for mayor of the city of New York. And you know, when you look at the history, we've had runoffs now in New York City for 40 years. Only twice in mayoral, only twice for all elections has the person who has come in second gone on to win in the runoff. Once in 1977, when Carol Bellamy upended the incumbent city council president, that was the former name of the public advocate's office, she went on to beat Paul O'Dwyer. And in 2001, ironically, it was Freddie Ferrer who won the first round, a Hispanic candidate, obviously, and Mark Green went on to win the runoff by, as you point out in your column, just a 16,000 votes. And so if we have only, in the last 40 years, only 6% of all those elections where the second place winner goes on and wins the runoff, that's another reason we ought to question whether a runoff makes any sense whatsoever. The first big reason is that we don't hold it for any of the other some 10,000 elected officials. The second one is, well, the person who's going to win the first round overwhelmingly usually wins the second round, so why have it?
This past primary, again, the New York City Board of Elections came under criticism, even though now there is an executive director in place after 2 years. Do you think that Michael Ryan has made a difference in office?
I think he's really trying. He's only been in office for a very short period of time. So he inherited a lot of the procedures, obviously a lot of the personnel, and I think that he's doing as good a job as possible under the circumstances. And by the way, I'll say that that's true for most of the board personnel. They're very hardworking people. They don't get paid very much, and they're doing the best they can under very trying circumstances. I don't think we ought to blame the people at the Board of Elections, really. I think it's the system that we have that needs to be reworked.
I've heard the board say that some of the problem with the accounting is a consequence of state statutes. Is that accurate?
Yes, it is.
And what do you think about fundamental changes that need to be made to the system? I mean, what are some of those reforms that you would implement?
Well, we've had now for many years a bipartisan election system, which means the boards of elections throughout the state need to be staffed by Republicans and Democrats. And it was originally thought that because they're bipartisan, that in a way everybody would be treated fairly. And to a large extent, that's true. But it seems to me that it might be, we might be better off if we had a nonpartisan, independent board of elections, so that everybody really felt that they were getting a fair shot when the respective boards made their rulings and they developed their procedures and they implemented their procedures. It seems to me that to have boards that are staffed with people from the two major parties, it seems anachronistic. It used to be that We had a very different system, but we've been doing this now since the mid-1970s, and it seems to me that it might be time for a change there as well. It would require not only state legislation, it would require a change to the state constitution.
Jerry Goldfeder, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
And that's it for this episode of Last Look. For more episodes, please join us on the web at cityandstateny.com.